Hachette Audio presents The Wilderness. Deep inside the Republican Party's combative, contentious, chaotic quest to take back the White House. Written by McKay Coppins. Read by John Glouchevitch. Dedication for Annie. A note on sourcing. This book is based on more than 300 interviews conducted between November 2012 and September 2015 with elected office holders, Republican Party officials, conservative movement leaders, media figures, top political operatives, consultants, activists, donors, and a wide range of family members, friends, and other confidants who have known the story's principal subjects at various stages of their lives. My conversations with these people occasionally stretched on for hours, and certain key sources graciously spoke with me dozens of times over the course of this project. The majority of these interviews took place on the record, but some were granted on the strict condition of anonymity, so that sources could candidly recount private conversations, provide behind-the-scenes details, and pass along other potentially sensitive information and insights. Wherever possible, their accounts were independently confirmed with notes, recordings, or interviews with other people who had knowledge of the given situations. In cases where substantive discrepancies existed between accounts, I worked to reconcile them through additional reporting, and ultimately used my best judgment to provide the most accurate and complete version of events. In a few instances, I have noted where a specific assertion is in dispute. Where dialogue is quoted, it is based on the recollection of the speaker, or someone else who was present for the conversation. If sources could not remember or agree on the specific wording, I reconstructed the dialogue without using quotation marks. Similarly, the considerable sections of this book that portray the various subjects' internal thoughts and feelings are based on descriptions from the subjects themselves or from people in whom they confided. Though my characterizations don't comprise direct quotes, they represent a sincere effort to accurately and emphatically capture the subject's thinking. Finally, portions of this book are drawn from my reporting and published stories at BuzzFeed News, as well as from the work of many talented authors and journalists at other outlets. I have relied occasionally on the official memoirs of my subjects in order to collect biographical information and sort out narrative timelines. But in general, I have treated these books like campaign documents, with all the journalistic skepticism such a category calls for. I certainly don't claim to know these men and women better than they know themselves, but the pursuit of political power requires even the most straightforward strivers to sterilize their personal narratives, a process that too often conceals the untidy chapters, unsightly secrets, and off-message anxieties that make them interesting human beings. Among its other objectives, this book intends to tell those stories. Introduction. The house lights in the campus auditorium fall. The audience grows quiet. A producer initiates the countdown. 4, 3, 2, and at precisely 9 p.m. Eastern Time, the cameras go hot. All at once, 70 million Americans are seeing the same tension-packed scene unfold in real time. Two commanding figures, both national celebrities loved and hated by millions, stride confidently toward each other from opposite ends of a vast, elaborately retrofitted stage. A white-hot glare beats down from the Klieg lights above. A clamorous applause rises from the seats below. Thousands of reporters in a nearby gymnasium sit, with their eyes glued to closed-circuit TVs, their twitchy fingers hovering over keyboards, preparing to chronicle every micro-moment. The two figures meet in the middle of the stage and shake hands with the menacing intensity of cage fighters entering a match. It is October 2016. The presidential race is in its final frenetic weeks. And the Republican nominee is about to go head-to-head with the Democratic candidate in the critical first debate of the general election. The stakes are high. Whoever wins the election will take office at a moment of uncommon uncertainty and upheaval in American life, tasked with setting the national agenda for the most contentious issues of the era, from racial injustice to religious freedom, from police accountability to privacy rights, from immigration to income inequality. The average age of the Supreme Court justices has now passed 70, and the next president could plausibly make as many as 4 new appointments to the bench, on top of thousands of other appointments across the judiciary and executive branches, an almost unprecedented opportunity to shape American jurisprudence for decades to come. Abroad, the growing terrorist threat of the Islamic State and the geopolitical bullying of countries like Russia will present the new commander-in-chief with a host of life and death, war and peace decisions that could have lasting global repercussions. And back home, the outcome of the election will almost certainly make the difference between an Oval Office occupant who celebrates, solidifies, and builds upon President Obama's liberal domestic policies, and one who spends the next 4 years actively working to unspool his legacy. The choice facing the country is stark, its consequences far-reaching, and it could all hinge on what happens on stage over the next 90 minutes. Tonight, the eyes of the nation are fixed on those two figures planted behind their podiums. Who does the audience see? When that pivotal moment arrives on an early October night in 2016, the candidate who shakes hands with the Democratic nominee in front of 70 million people will have traveled an unprecedented path to get there. He will have fought off the largest field of Republican contenders in a century, vanquishing at least 16 serious rivals in all. He will have raised enough money to dominate the most expensive presidential race in American history, with an expected price tag of $5 billion. He will have logged enough miles in flight on the campaign trail to circle the globe a dozen times. And he will have done it all amid the high drama, high octane clashes of ego and ideology that have raged inside the GOP, in cinematic public spectacles and clandestine, cutthroat maneuvering, since the Republicans' dizzying defeat on the night of the 2012 election. What follows is a chronicle of that once-in-a-generation battle over the future of the Republican Party, told through its most influential, provocative, and fascinating combatants, virtually all of whom hope to make it to that debate stage, and, ultimately, the White House. Part 1. Exile. Chapter 1. The Exodus. November 6th, 2012. Election Day. If ever there was a moment when Senator Rand Paul needed to make use of his God-given poker face, the small mouth that rested in a gently sloped, unreadable frown, the impassive, pale blue eyes that betrayed no hint at his innermost thoughts, it was right now, this instant, this night, in this dimly lit, log-framed, antler-adorned restaurant function room in Bowling Green, Kentucky, with these crestfallen conservatives standing all around him. The National Republican Party was imploding on live television. Dispatches from the calamity were being beamed in from Fox News headquarters and blasting out of TVs mounted on the walls of Montana Grill in Rand's small hometown. Colorado going blue. North Carolina too close to call. Todd Akin getting pummeled in Missouri. Scott Brown down in New Hampshire. And then, the contingent of local Republicans who had gathered to watch the returns fell silent as the candy-colored Chiron delivered the doomsday headline: Barack Obama reelected president. Rand was the most senior Republican official in the room, and he knew all eyes were on him. The appropriate, senatorial thing to do here was to quietly broadcast his sober disappointment in a country gone astray, to nod in solidarity at the tough nights and what a shames, to express solemn regret that Americans were going to miss out on such a fine, righteous president as Willard Mitt Romney. It was not a pose that came naturally to Rand, but he had picked up a few things since his scrappy...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.